angry and they're hostile. It's where new wave punk rock is coming from, pretty much. And that was the Dead Boys, one of the most hostile groups, and incidentally one of the best new wave bands that I've heard on record so far. They have a new album out now, a whole bunch of new wave albums coming out this fall. And in fact, we're going to check one from Richard Hell and the Voidoids in just a second here.
My name is Mark. I'm husband of Susie Davis and son-in-law of the late, great Norman Davis. Thank you. A big welcome and thanks to all of you for coming. Sort of looking around at our demographics and the judging by the average age, I think many of you may have had choices of which memorial to attend today, and we're very glad you picked ours. Thank you. I want to thank the California Radio Society for inviting us to hold Norman's memorial here in this amazing space. Yeah. The Society does sort of this incredible, essential work in keeping alive the memories and history of the Bay Area radio scene, so thank you so much for that. We're here to celebrate Norman's life. I was thinking, well, how should we do that? And I was pondering the unanswered question, for which there is still no t-shirt, of what would Norman do? And actually, I think the answer might be, figure it out and then get someone else to do it. He was pretty good at that. Speaking of, I was thinking about what to wear this morning for the memorial, and I realized there is no inappropriate dress for this, which I think says a lot about the way Norman accepted folks regardless of their appearance. Many of my memories of Norman center around his time on the Mesa in New Mexico, and that was the tail end of when Norman believed that he had no need for hospitals or doctors, and if he just had some THC and a way to broadcast, everything would be fine. On a more spiritual note, Susie and I are founding members of the Church of the Ignorostics. We believe the only thing we know for sure is that we don't know anything for sure. Our ignorance is our North Star. And Norman would have certainly been a member, and maybe he was, I can't remember. He might not have been able to afford the initiation fees. In any case, I think he would agree that the only sane response to our profound ignorance about life and death is to be grateful for the blessings and small mercies that surround us every day. He had a long, full, beautiful life surrounded by friends and families. Let's be grateful for what he had in this world and that we each got to know him in all of his charms, talents, flaws, and foibles. In other words, in all his humanity. And by the way, Norman died a pauper, so if you feel inclined to contribute to the costs associated with celebrating his life today, there's a little area in the back. No pressure. I'm just, as they say, giving you the opportunity. And I believe next is a video?
Yes, right.
Is that right? Now is a video by Norman's son, Scott Davis.
Norman Elwood Davis was born February 26, 1935, in Walla Walla, Washington, to newlyweds Elwood and Hazel. He was difficult from the start and had to be forced out using the tongs. It was the height of the Great Depression. The Davis family had plenty to be depressed about. Unlike other toddlers who sat around playing all day, Norman was quickly put to work, sweeping and hammering. Around the age of 3, Norman saw a radio for the first time. He thought it must be magic to have music coming out of that little box, and was forever intrigued by it. For a time, they lived in the woods in a trailer his father had built. Here, Norman shows the fish that he caught, which was strange because the whole family was vegetarian, as was the Adventist's doctrine. His mother, Hazel, was a staunch Seventh-day Adventist. Norman vividly remembered being put to bed, and his mother telling him that Jesus would return any day now, and that the Adventists were the only ones going to heaven, so he better be a good boy, Hazel fervently believed that Jesus was returning any day up until she passed away 55 years later. By the age of 5, Norman's father had taught him to play violin, and he was put on a local radio station to play one of his all-time favorite songs. Sometime later, he wrote a story and sent it in to a kids' magazine, and they gave him a free subscription. There were activities and games inside, and in the back was a serial story that continued in each issue. He never got to read the story because his mother glued the pages together before she would give him the magazine. Because fiction stimulated the imagination, and the imagination is the playground of the devil. This dominant censorship on his early life was probably a large contributing factor to his push to live life to the fullest later on. Eventually, they ended up in Casper, Wyoming, where his first little sister Sue was born.
And there was much rejoicing.
And from there, they would move to Boise, Idaho, and soon to the home on Hill Road. His second little sister, Marilyn, was then born.
And there was much rejoicing.
Norman would attend Gem State Academy, the Adventist boarding high school. There, they were taught true Christian values, but could be kicked out for not worshiping the Lord enough, or in the case of Norman's future daughter Susie, for being a witch. Norman was a blossoming rebel and would sometimes break out of his room at night and sneak over to the bakery nearby. He knew of an open window he could reach with a ladder, and he went in and stole a few donuts. Norman graduated from Gem State at the age of 16. Either he was really smart, or he really hated Gem State and would do anything to get out of there early. His next stop was the Adventist-run Walla Walla University. His mother picked out his classes for him and thought it would be nice if he learned typing, shorthand, printing, and whatnot. He was the only male in many of his classes. That might have been okay, except he was only 16, and all the girls thought of him as just a boy. It wasn't long before he completely lost interest in school. His GPA was 1.28, he rarely went to worship services, and he may even been seen smoking a cigarette. That was enough to get him kicked out. Back to Boise and his wonderful life of clean living. But that didn't last long. He enrolled in Boise Junior College and did much better. He was able to pick the classes he wanted, and for the first time, he wasn't barraged by religious dogma. He took a radio broadcast class, and through that was able to get his first disc jockey job at KGEM in 1953. At the age of 20, he landed his first full-time DJ job at KSEI in Pocatello. At this point, he either wanted a career as a DJ or a jazz piano player. He actually performed a show at a club in Pocatello. By 1956, he knew radio was his life, but not in Pocatello. So he moved on to KHQ in Spokane. It was there that he met Rosetta. They hit it off, and by 1958 were married. As Norman was always on the hunt for bigger and better things, they moved to Sausalito, California, and Norman got a job at KOBY in San Francisco. Their first child, Susie, was born in 1959. Shortly after, he switched stations to KYA. He would spend 5 years at KYA, which is one of his longer gigs. As a promotional stunt, Norman did a radio marathon where he stayed on the radio for 108 hours straight. For doing so, KYA gave him a trip to Hawaii. Life was pretty good in Sausalito. The Marin County climate was such that you could sunbathe year-round. Norman would return to the Bay Area many times throughout his life, usually working in San Francisco, but always living just north in Marin County. It was like Christmas every day. Norman always got the best presents. In 1962, they took a vacation to Idaho. Here they are leaving Sausalito. And here they are immediately leaving the old Hill Road house because Hazel insisted they go to church with her. And back to home. Stephen was born in 1963. Norman's sister Sue came to visit them at Lake Tahoe, which she soon regretted. Norman was always looking for the get-rich-quick scheme. Here in Silver City, on another visit to Idaho, he and Sister Sue are certain they have found buried treasure. But, as everyone knows, none of his plans for fortune ever worked out. In 1964, he and Susie got the mumps. It hurt too much to shave, so he let his beard grow. He got over the mumps, but he liked the beard, and it never left his face from then on. A typical day for Norman was to wake in the morning and get ready for work. Then, Rosetta would fix him a hearty and healthy breakfast. Off to work he would go. Upon his return, he was attacked by the kids, eager to play throughout the evening. In 1965, they made the move to KLZ in Denver, Colorado, and before the year was up, third child Sean was born. In addition to being a DJ, Norman also landed a television job as a Saturday afternoon host for a movie series that featured B-grade sci-fi classics. His character was called Count Sivan. Another trip to Idaho in 66 for some aquatic fun. Tubing the river was already popular, but sucking rocks out of the river was something Norman pioneered. By 1967, it was time to move on. So he threw the kids in the car, and they were off. They ended up at KCMO in Kansas City. Steve and Susie seemed happy about it. Even at great distance, he still came to visit his parents and sisters in Boise. It was in 1969 that Norman went nuts. He was introduced to the hippie lifestyle and he was forever changed. He began smoking pot and taking psychedelics. Lots of psychedelics. Another typical Thanksgiving dinner with the family, except Norman is too high to wear any clothes. When he showed up to work, blazing on LSD, and he couldn't get through a commercial script without losing his place, he was fired. His fourth and final child, Scott, was born amidst this chaos. He moved the family to his mom's place in Boise, and after some fun with Scott, he and a couple of groovy hippie girls hitchhiked to San Francisco to see if he could find a job. Certainly, Rosetta was thrilled. He found a job at KSFO and moved the family to San Rafael in Marin County, where they could resume a normal, healthy family life. A year later, it was on up to Eugene, Oregon, and KZEL. There, he could sit in a psychedelic park with Scotty while on psychedelics. And then in 72, it was back to San Fran, where he landed the 2 a.m. to 6 a.m. shift at KSAN. He loved being back in Marin County. He could pick free figs on the roadside, there was nude swimming by the river, and there were giant magic mushrooms. KSAN was a perfect fit for Norman. It was up to the DJs to decide what to play, which was and still is a rarity in radio. None of the sponsors, owners, or the FCC were listening in the middle of the night, so he could get away with almost anything on his show. His radio genius was unleashed and his creativity mushroomed. Literally mushroomed. He took a lot of them.
One of my dealer friends gave me some mushrooms one night. And they were immensely powerful and, you know, put you right in the angelic choir kind of category. And so I became practically religious about it and started handing them out to everybody and giving them, and I kept getting more and kept taking more. And I found that I was running on this energy. I didn't eat much, might have an apple or something, but I wasn't eating much, just running on this beam of light. And this went on for quite some time, I don't know, 3 or 4 weeks maybe. And then Tom O'Hare came to me one night and kind of confidentially said, Norman, some of us think you might be doing a little too much on the mushrooms, and maybe you ought to cut back a little. So I did.
The KSAN era was a quintessential representation of the 70s. The rock station was creative, progressive, and revolutionary. It was also a non-stop party of inebriants, stimulants, psychedelics, and sex. Norman's typical day was to wake up around 4 p.m. and have breakfast, which was the family dinner. He would prep for his show for a couple of hours and then head into San Francisco. He would go to clubs, concerts, and parties until his shift started at 2 a.m. At 6 a.m., he would drive home, often in no condition to drive, go to sleep, and repeat.
Well, it's time to party. Looks like I got you in a stranglehold today. Well, hope you're feeling great and you have a super day. Don't catch any of that cat scratch fever. Hey, all right, dude. Now I want you to party and party hard. Rock on, dude. Rock and roll.
Sometimes he would overdo it a bit. In this photo, his boys didn't know why he was laying on the ground just outside the front door, but they made it into a game and continued to jump over him. He had snorted some PCP mixed with LSD and was unable to move. He was probably seeing comets whiz by as he floated towards Saturn. Outside of KSAN, he spent time with the family. In 1974, he and his sisters and all their kids did a backpack trip led by his brother-in-law Steve Plummer. He often took the family to the beach, Mount Tam, or the various attractions in San Francisco. In 1975, he bought a camper truck with all sorts of cool features, none of which worked, but it was still better than the ridiculously mechanically unreliable van that they had. They went north through Oregon and took a sure thing shortcut, which resulted in a dead end, but they eventually found the pot shop. In 76, they took a vacation to Canada and narrowly avoided being busted at the border for having a large amount of pot. Because they looked like hippies, the border agents searched the camper. By some miracle, they didn't notice the quart-sized jar full of pot, with just a piece of paper taped on the outside to hide its contents. The agent literally pushed it to the side to look behind it. On the way back, they made a quick stop at the drug fair, and then on to Boise, where his mother quickly put Norman to work. He escaped that and went on a backpacking trip with his sisters Sue and Marilyn and Steve Plummer. They went to Cabin Creek Lake. Here, Norman is seen making lines out of a white powder he had brought, and the rest of the trip he had fire coming out of his eyes. In 1977, Norman began an affair with the young lady Kim Wybrew. In 78, K-San was sold and the new owner changed the format to all country music. Norman was quickly fired when he refused to play Dolly Parton and Kenny Rogers. At this point, he and Rosetta split up. The kids stayed with Rosetta and Norman moved to Santa Cruz with Kim. He got a job at KSJO in San Jose. A year later, Norman and Kim moved to Portland, Oregon, and in 1981, they moved back to Marin County. Norman continued to work at various radio stations, and now that he lived nearby Rosetta and his kids, he would spend more time with his family. In 1984, he and his sisters organized a family reunion in Boise for their parents' 50th wedding anniversary.
And the co-host.
The children of the Davises.
We are the children, and we're responsible for this epic event. And all of us have felt the hand of our mom and our dad. And are probably more familiar with them than anybody else here.
By 1984, Norman and Kim had found a shack-like house in the woods to rent in Lagunitas. They had a cat, Mr. Mojo, and a dog, Polly Sorbate 80. Susie, Steve, and Sean all inherited Norman's musical talents. Susie sang and played keyboards and had a very successful career as a musician. Steve and Sean played guitar but did not make it big. Here they jammed together at Norman's house. In 1985, he was working at KTIM. He and Susie came to Rosetta's for Thanksgiving. Here he reunites with his old cat Tiva, named for cannabis sativa, of course. Norman enjoyed playing golf with his sons.
What's your strategy on this hole? You can't really see anything.
Well, this hole, you gotta go over this hill, about 100 feet to the top. I'm gonna hit it.
Looks like a mountain range to me.
I'll lead the way, you follow.
Some 384 yards.
Yes! On, lead on, Norm! Lead on!
It's over the hill.
Boy, what a leader!
This is Norman Davis, father of the bride.
Oh, excuse me, I was in the Bahamas there.
Oh, how's the weather? Good?
It was really
How's
nice.
The water?
Blue.
Good, good. Was it warm?
It was warm.
Was it sand white? Was it between your toes and in your crotch?
I think I'll go back.
Okay, bye-bye. Norman?
In 1986, his oldest son Steve was living by himself in San Francisco. He made plans to come over to Rosetta's house on Halloween evening, but never showed up and was never seen again. There were never any clues as to what happened to him. This had a huge impact on Norman as well as the rest of the family. In 1987, Norman did some camping in Idaho. And also that year, he had a couple celebrities visit him. Your typical Christmas dinner photo. The typical birthday dinner photo. And he did some more camping. His son Sean was a brilliant artist and in 1988 graduated from art college, which was followed by 40 years of struggling poverty. In 1989, Kim and Norman broke up. Probably in response, Norman moved to Grants Pass, Oregon, to work at a radio station with a longtime friend, Bill Scott. But, like most Norman's grand plans, it fizzled out. The radio job was a dead end. He did manage to start an all-blues show in the nearby town of Medford. From then on, Norman would mainly focus on the blues. After a year in Grants Pass, he fled. And the only place he had to flee was back to Boise, to the same old house, to the same old room, with his same old parents. While in Boise, he started a new show, the Sunday Brunch Blues, and he also helped start the Boise Blues Society. His son Scott moved in with him in 1991, and his sister Marilyn lived across the street. The rest of the family would come to Boise in the summer, and they would go backpacking. They went to Upper Hell Roaring Lake in the Sawtooth Mountains, and he found some crystals. They went to Boast Lake in the Sawtooths with his brother-in-law, Daryl Van Sickle. Norman did some high-altitude balloon training before they went to China Lake in the Frank Church Wilderness. And they went to Kemmerer Lake in the White Cloud Mountains. In 1994, he met Marcia St. John. They hit it off and were married in November. Marcia got a job with United Airlines in Portland, Oregon, and so they moved there in 95. Norman found a station that would air his next weekly blues show, The Midnight Flyer. Eventually, a syndicator picked up the show, and it has been on the air ever since. But a once-weekly show didn't really pay the bills, so Norman had to get a job at a record and CD store. In 1998, Marcia's job relocated her to Tampa, Florida. So they packed up a truck again and moved across the country. It should be noted that Norman had amassed a huge music library by this time, and it moved with him wherever he went. The numbers went up and down, but in the end, he ended up with about 5,500 records, about 15,000 CDs, mostly blues, thousands of cassettes, and hundreds of reel-to-reel tapes. Anybody out there want to buy some records and CDs? Cheap? Please? But back to the story. Also in 1998, Norman became a grandfather to Reva Davis, courtesy of Scott and his partner Trish. In 1999, there was a return to the annual camping trip, but this time it was just car camping.
You have that thing in your mouth.
Camping trip in 2000 was the last one he would do. In 2001, his second grandchild was born, Quinn Davis, courtesy of Sean and his wife Dana. He approved. Also in 2001, Marcia's job moved them to Salt Lake City. In 2003, Marcia quit her job for United and they moved to Taos, New Mexico, eventually ending up in Carson, outside of Taos. Norman loved Carson. It was a small community of hippies, freaks, and outright weirdos that had abandoned modern society to go live in the middle of nowhere. Marcia worked in Taos, and Norman stayed home where friends and neighbors would frequently come to visit. In 2004, his third grandchild, Barrett, was born to Scott and Trish. A young couple, Jamie and Devin, were neighbors and friends of Norman. They had a baby named Wiley. Oftentimes, Jamie and Devin had to work at the same time, so Norman and Marcia offered to babysit for Wiley. Norman bonded with Wiley and loved spending time with him. For years, his password for various accounts was, "I love Wiley." Norman would come to visit his family in 2005. go to see his nephew Jake Plummer play football in 2006, and another trip to Boise in 2009. And family would go visit him in New Mexico. The longest Norman ever lived in one place was in Carson, which was 11 years. He had been married to Marcia for 20 years, but in 2014 they broke up. Marcia moved out and never spoke to him again. Norman, 79 years old, could not survive on his own, so his only option was to move back to Boise, to the same old house, to his same old room. At this point, his sister Sue was living there. Most people would just fade away at this point, but not Norman. In 2014, he was inducted into the Bay Area Radio Hall of Fame. He scoured the internet for female blues harmonica players, and found enough of them to produce an album called Blues Harp Women. He also produced Idaho Women Sing the Blues and Blues Gems from the Gem State. He got a slot at KBRX Radio Boise for a 3-hour weekly blues show titled The Juke Joint. He organized a blues cruise, which was a large boat tour on Payette Lake with live bands performing. He continued to put out midnight flyer shows as he had for over 20 years. He started a second weekly show on Radio Boise of swing music called Swing State. He attended nearly every blues performance in Boise, which were several a month. He stayed ridiculously busy for a man in his 80s. When COVID hit, he stopped going to the radio station to do his show live. But no man is impervious to time. In May of 2022, at the age of 87, he collapsed and was taken to the hospital. He was expected to pass any time and put into hospice, but with great support from his family and friends, Norman slowly improved and was taken out of hospice. Norman's primary motivation was to get back on the radio. After nearly 6 months of recovery, he completed his first comeback show. His friend Evelyn, who took over the juke joint, agreed to give him 1 hour in the middle of her show. Norman was living in a nursing home, but friends and family volunteered to take him 3 times a week to his old home where he could work on his show. In 2023, he turned 88. He always wanted to live to be 88 because this was the number of keys in a piano. His 32nd comeback show aired on January 29th. He went to his studio and worked on number 33 earlier that day. That night, he passed away in his sleep, 1 month before his 89th birthday. Norman was always looking forward. Just in his last month, he was planning on interviewing people in his nursing home and creating a podcast. He had talked about extending his comeback show to 2 hours. He was attempting to convert old cassette recordings to digital to archive them, and he frequently talked about living to the age of 91 so that he could beat his mother, who made it to 90. He believed that human potential was unlimited. He used a lot of drugs to try and expand his mind, but he believed that drugs only triggered something that was already in the brain. Ultimately, we could learn to trigger that without the use of drugs, and that would be the next step in human evolution. Agree with him or not, but a world of peace and love where everyone is naturally high all the time doesn't sound that bad. So long, Norm. It was nice knowing you.
I'm Susie Davis, and I'm Norman's daughter, and my brother Scott made that video. Scott lives up in Idaho. Yeah. Yeah, it's beautifully irreverent, and I know that Norman would love it. I am just feeling so grateful today for all of you showing up to honor my dad's memory. And just to be here and take the time to celebrate this unique and wonderful guy. I'm grateful that Dad lived such an adventurous life that he warranted a feature obit in the San Francisco Chronicle. Way to go, Norman. He really did get to lead an amazing life, and then at the end, he even got an extra 2 years out of the deal, which was quite something. Dad was often known to say, "I have a great idea," which really meant, "I have a great idea of something that you should do for me." And what was amazing was that there was always people around him who would step up and do just that. Up in Boise, he had my brother Scott, who endlessly volunteered to fix his computer and his phone and every other broken thing that he had. He also had nephews that would come by the house and help out in the garden and help fix up the old house when it was falling apart. He had his sisters, Sue and Marilyn, who were just so incredible and supportive of him. His sister Sue did all of the cooking for them while he lived with her. And then he also had this amazing group of friends who visited him through his illness and then continued to support him in myriad ways, signing up to give him those weekly rides from his from the assisted living facility to his house just so he could make his shows. It was really amazing to see Team Norman in action. So in real life, he was surrounded by angels.
Norman. Thanks, Norman. That's Norman. That's, and he's playing
a prank. Yeah. Oh, it's a smoke alarm. All right,
that's perfectly fitting.
Oh my God.
Steve, I thought you said people could smoke in here. So anyway, in real life, Dad really was surrounded by angels, but he was also surrounded by them in the metaphysical world as well. He was an incredibly lucky person. How he never got busted for the things he did in the 70s is completely beyond me. So I had a very wild childhood because my dad fully embraced the counterculture ethos from the time I was age 10 and on. When we were living in Eugene, Dad had gone down to San Francisco to start working at KSAN, and that's where he got into the mushrooms. One time he came back to Eugene to visit us, and he brought this huge bag of these very special mushrooms with him. I mean, like a garbage bag full, and he just left them in the fridge. And so, of course, me and my other eighth grade friends would like come home after school and just dip our hands in the bag of mushrooms and then go out and drive around with the older boys in their cars. And it's like, yeah, what could possibly go wrong there? And then that time that we got stopped at the Canadian border and the agents missed the jar of pot under the sink. Well, once they finally let us go and we were rolling down the road, all of us feeling this incredible sense of relief, I opened the door of the refrigerator and I saw this folded yellow piece of, it was folded in a triangle, yellow paper, yellow ledger paper. It was just sitting on the door of the fridge. Well, it was a large bundle of Coke, which they just happened to miss too. And so we just always felt that it had to have been angels protecting us that day. In many ways, Dad was sort of an innocent. He was a bit hapless, never one to really think about the future. And hence, when he needed to go into assisted living, he had no assets and qualified for Medicaid. Yeah! A total blessing to his family. Then there was also a procedure that he got back in 2021 at Stanford where they blasted a section of his brain that was causing these extreme tremors with high frequency sound waves. We came home from the hospital the same day and I watched him eat soup with a spoon for the first time in years. And somehow Stanford just picked up the entire bill for that. I'm also feeling really grateful just for the weird and unique experiences that Dad gave me. As a child, he taught me to always be open to new things, and as a teenager, how to actively subvert the dominant paradigm, and to always do it with humor, irreverence, and a go-for-broke kind of attitude, and psychedelics whenever possible. and the music, of course. Growing up with the music always playing in the house, with music at the center of my dad's creativity and his celebrity, having access to this incredible record collection as a teenager, my love of music and hence my choice of career was completely because of my dad's influence. And I'm also just really thankful for his lifelong devotion to his creative expression. He was always full of ideas up until the very end. On our last phone call together, a few days before he died, he told me that he had a great idea for a new podcast. It would be called Talking with Russ. And it would be just him and Russ, who was his 98-year-old friend at the nursing home, sitting down and having a conversation. They had dinner together every night, and he thought that what they talked about was so interesting that the rest of the world would want to hear it as well. And then, of course, in the nursing home, he totally became a rock star there, too. Very soon, he got elected as the president of the residence council and started pushing for his ideas to improve their experience there, which included suet feeders in the bird in the trees outside the windows and a very small community garden. So, you know, one thing that has made his passing easier to deal with is that the last 2 years with him were really just frosting on the cake. In his obituary, the San Francisco Chronicle said that he was perhaps the only disc jockey to return to the air after 6 weeks in hospice care. Because, of course, being Norman, once he realized that he had a new lease on life, the only thing he wanted to do is get back on the radio. And those extra years were really sweet. In the end, he really used them to be the kindest version of himself and tell the people he loved that he loved them. He also experienced a renewed appreciation for the beauty of life. While he was still in the hospital, we spent a lot of time listening to music, and he'd often ask me to play his favorite song for him. It's a standard called But Beautiful. And I'd put it on the speaker, and he would just start weeping, just moved to the depth by the tenderness and heart-aching beauty that is life. And so I'm going to bring up Pamela Rose, and we're going to sing But Beautiful for you.
Love is funny, or it's sad, or it's quiet, or it's mad. It's a good thing, or it's bad. But beautiful, beautiful to take a chance, and if you fall, you fall. Tearful, or it's gay. It's a problem, or it's play. It's a heartache, either way, but beautiful. And I'm I know. for to take a chance. And if you fall, you fall. And I'm thinking I wouldn't mind at all. Love is tearful or it's gay. It's a problem or it's play. It's a heartache either way, but beautiful. And I'm thinking if you were mine, I'd
have some friends of Norman's come up and tell some stories, and I think we're going to bring up Ben Fong Torres first.
Thank you, Susie. Thank you to Norman too for bringing us together to yet another of these reunions where you go up to somebody and say, hey, great to see you. And I am, right. Well, it was April 21st, 1973. KSAN, the Jive 95, was producing yet another Live at the Record Plant broadcast in Sausalito. Bluegrass and grass ruled the day. Jerry Garcia's band Old and In the Way played. So did Jesse Colin Young and Joy of Cooking and, believe it or not, Sha Na Na. I was a weekend DJ and Diane, my wife, and I were there. Norman was there, the all-night DJ and production director, along with Rick Sadle, the creative director. We remember Norman more than any of the bands. You know why? That's because at one of the many breaks between bands, he invited Diane and me out to his VW van where he produced Magic Mushrooms. A station break. We then went out for a magical mystery spin before returning to the plant. I think this might be Norman's second favorite song after But Beautiful. And you've just had some kind of mushroom, and your mind is moving low. Go ask Norman, I think he'll know. I always thought of Norman as somewhat magical himself. We both were at KSAN in 1976 when Rolling Stone magazine hired him to engineer and co-produce a syndicated radio special I had written on the occasion of the 10th anniversary of the Summer of Love. What a long, strange trip. What a cliche title. Norman was a wizard at the board and at the tape editing machinery, as well as on mic. He helped piece together dozens of sound bites from the likes of Jerry Garcia, Steve Miller, and Grace Slick, blended in the music, and engineered my narration. He spliced together a montage of songs mentioning San Francisco, from Chuck Berry to Bonzo Dog. Superb editing. And he read the commercials for the sponsor Pioneer Stereo. He was a total pro, and there were no mushrooms in sight. Maybe a joint or two, but not a hint of psilocybin. Only once in a while did I let myself think, hey, this is the guy who was Lucky Logan in the early 60s, playing requests and dedications on the Boss of the Bay, KYA. But actually, I was from Oakland. We had KEWB. color channel 91. So I didn't hear that much of Lucky until the management ordered him to revert to his real name, and then I heard Norman Davis on KSFO and KSAN. And by the way, the special we produced together won that year's Billboard Award for Broadcast Excellence. I think of it as Norman's Award. Norman and I were friends to the end. Norman left KSAN and ultimately San Francisco, but he never abandoned the station. And he was on the air spinning his favorite music, the blues, to the end. As for KSAN, he was the keeper of the archives at jive95.com for decades, collecting jingles, air checks, specials, and I'm sure those record plant live shows. When he attended a KSAN reunion, including one produced by the broadcast legends, he brought along a gigantic scrapbook or two all about the station and its people. When Norman learned that I was DJing and programming an online station, Moon Alice Radio, he proudly sent me a couple of CDs he had produced, one called Blues Harp Women, and featuring exactly that, and recorded intros for me to use. He had a blues show in syndication, The Midnight Flyer. I loved his voice, a natural, friendly, conversational voice, perfectly suited for FM freewheeling radio. He had the talent to bend himself into being a top 40 jock, to being Lucky Logan, or anything the bosses demanded. But in the end, he was free again, back in Boise again, on the air, as ever, as Norman Davis, forever the Midnight Flyer. Thank you.
Oh, stop. Bonnie, would you like to come up?
Sure.
Yeah, and if anybody wants to come up, just it's going to be open mic from here on out. Okay.
I'm just going to fill in a hole that came up during the film. My office at KSAN, the production studio was right behind it, and the glass was between the production studio and the library. And Norman seemed to suddenly be coming in, and after we get off at 6 a.m, he would go in the production studio, and he was working really seriously on something. And this went on for weeks. And weeks, and it was very unusual for him to be doing that, and he would work in there until the production people came in at 9 or so and took over their shift. And this was also when he was taking small amounts of mushrooms almost every day. But you know, I gotta say, Norman, he never missed his show. Through it all, he was always a consummate professional. You would never know, and I never worried about Norman. He was one of the few people I never worried about in that regard. And every once in a while, I'd say, Norman, what are you working on? And you go, oh, I can't tell you yet, but it's going to be really good. Weeks and weeks, and every week or so I'd ask him, and he still wouldn't let me in on it. And finally one day, he said, come in the production studio. I'm gonna let you hear it. And he put on this tape, and he looked at me with that sort of wonderful Cheshire Cat Norman smile. And there was nothing on that tape. I swear to you, it was 15 minutes of absolute silence. And I knew that Norman was playing with the spheres, perhaps, in a more serious sense than he should. When Norman was in hospice, his wonderful daughter, Susie, was doing everything she could to sort of hook us all up so that we could talk to Norman. And I talked to him a few times. And Susie, I might have the chronology all wrong, but it seems to me that after talking to him a couple of times and thinking it was the last conversation I would have with my friend Norman after 50-some years, I was talking to him one day, and he said, you know, apparently I'm getting better. And I'm really happy I'm getting married.
Oh, yeah.
And there was a woman that was sort of helping him. Norman was very good at always having friends around who would help. Yeah, yeah. And apparently in Norman's head, I don't think that ever happened, did it?
Oh, that's a long story.
But it was so wonderful. And I'm sure you also had something to do with this, but shortly before Norman passed away, I got a little button in the mail with a great picture of Norman that I'm really used to, this little picture of Norman. And it said, "Keep on smiling." And it's up on my refrigerator right now. It's gonna stay there forever. So Norman, see ya when I get to the other side.
Yeah. All right, pardon me if I fill in some holes as well. I'm Paul Wells, also known as Lobster. I started doing radio in the Bay Area. There were five FM rock stations at the time when I moved from New York City. KSJO and KOME in San Jose, KSAN, KSFX, and KMPX was still on the air in San Francisco. In fact, Tom Ballantyne, are you here? There's Tom. Tom and I worked together when I was the kid on the air staff at KSJO. After working at KOME, I went back to KSJO. But when I was music director of Stanford's radio station in 72, I'd go hang out with Norman Davis on the air. It was always an adventure being with him. The most meticulous DJ I've ever seen in my life, because he worked with a pitch pipe so that he knew what keys songs were in. He had his book organized by category, by topic. He was a computer that was programming music before computers programmed music. And his love of music was part of the feeling that I got and the inspiration I got. And I considered him a mentor. And to fill in one little blank, he didn't leave KSAN when it went country. Might want to have that corrected by your brother. He left KSAN before that, in late 78, I believe, because I don't think that the ink dried on his paycheck before we hired him to be creative director of KSJO in San Jose. And that's where he and Kim had the place in Santa Cruz. And that was a great time. Norman invented guerrilla marketing for our radio station, which we call the Rock and Roll Traveling Circus. And we never thought of ourselves as just Santa Clara County, San Jose. We looked at Alameda County and San Mateo County as the trenches between the two cities of San Jose and San Francisco. And we'd fight for the audience to gain territory. And so we did this traveling rock and roll circus everywhere, from Salinas and Monterey all the way up to San Mateo and Fremont. And very often, with no permit, to have a flatbed truck and a band and a juggler and all the DJs and rolls. And we were just shit disturbing all over the Bay Area. So it was the perfect thing for Norman to come along and say, "Hey, let's do this." And it worked. It was a good time for the station. And I think another thing, the irreverence for the sponsors, I can tell one KSAN story, because I didn't get to work at KSAN till after El Nuclear Warhead, as we fondly called L. David Moorhead, yes. Yeah, took over the station. And my first meeting at KSAN, I'll just say this, in the office that had been, when they moved to that bank building, Tom Donahue have that office for a little while? They moved from Sutter Street there? I'm not quite sure, because I wasn't there. But I know that was a great office. It had its own shower. And El Nuclear Warhead's behind his desk, and one of the people he brought up from L.A. leans over to me and goes, "You know, you can tell when he's been shooting speed because his jaw doesn't stop twitching." And then leans back, just whispered, and I look up, and sure enough, he's... Mm-hmm. What a piece of work to work for. He kind of liked me, because I was doing 10 p.m. to 2 a.m., and he'd show up at 2 a.m. and ask me to play Jackie Wilson Said or something like that, you know. Or play Jackie Wilson, for that matter. So it was quite an experience to be in KSAN at Jive 95 right before the last wall of the castle fell into the swamp, which is the way I looked at it, and I was back in San Jose by the time that happened. But I'll tell you one thing that happened with a reverence to commercials, but with Norman, sometimes he would just do something that was just funny, and I never remember having any crosswords with him at all. We just got along from the time I was the kid showing up at KSAN till I was music director and assistant PD of KSJO, and we hired him, you know, as soon as we knew he was available. So Ricky Lee Jones' first album came out, and Norman had the assignment of making the commercial for the debut album of Ricky Lee Jones. And he came up with a commercial, and in the commercial, he referred to the album cover and said, "Isn't he cute?" I had to say, Norman, it's spelled with an I, Ricky. Well, you know, he'd lead with his sense of humor. I got to speak to him in his final days. And it's producing the show, and it was a miracle, Susie, that you had those last 2 years. And I will never forget Norman. Thank you.
Thank you.
I got to talk on this 44. Oh, yeah. Why are we here? Oh, Norman, yes, of course. 1969. I had just started at KSFO, and it was an AM straight station. Everybody looked like they played golf, you know. And one afternoon, Al Newman says, "I want you to meet somebody." Took me into the production office, and there was this crazy, long-haired, multicolored, crazy man standing there. And I immediately liked him. I thought, this is a neat-looking guy. Who is this? Norman Davis, Electric Mind Garden?
Organic.
Organic! Yeah. Please, Organic Mind Garden.
Correct speaker.
All I can say is, over the years, every time I would run into him or we would work together, it was always fun. He was absolutely in love with what he did, and when you were with him, you couldn't help get caught up in it. I did the early morning show, and I would get in, as Bonnie knows, real early to get my show ready. About 5 after 6. And there on the floor, oftentimes, was your father and you and some other people on the floor playing the pitch pipe. And I realized, these people take their segues very, very seriously. And so I was very self-conscious, you know. So one morning I did decide to come in early and prepare a little bit and really kick off my show so Norma would be impressed. So I get there about 5 or 6. And he pulls out a joint. Ah. So I pulled out one. McQueen walks in and he pulls out one. Now we got 3 duelists. Cannabis duelist, and we all, I guess, just stood right there. We didn't have to hide out anywhere. And we all started smoking, and my producer started my first set. And then everybody else left, and I was there, ready to do my show. I was absolutely blind. I couldn't speak. I had no idea what I was doing. I almost called Bonnie and cried, "Come and get me, please." But I did decide one thing, never to come to work early again. And that's what Norman taught me. God bless you.
Hi, my name's Jim DeVille. This is so great. Thank you, Susie, for putting this together. When I left the Air Force in 1980 in Marin County, I got a job at United Liquors on 4th Street in San Rafael. It was right around the corner from KTIM, AM, and FM. I got to know some of the jocks who drank, all of them, and started hanging out at the station at night. The next thing I knew, I was entering as the public service coordinator, thank you, Doreen, wherever you are, opening the mail. I didn't know it at the time, but I was surrounded by radio legends, including one Norman Davis. I wanted to be a disc jockey since I was in high school, and now I had found my radio tribe. Norman was the PD on the AM side. 1510, the big band blend. Say that three times. Norman hired radio legends, including Bobby Dale, who is enshrined here. Yeah, give it up for Bobby. And Jim Watt, remember the mustache? Yes, indeed. Folks like Cab Calloway would stop by KTM and hang out. That was so cool. I left KTM in 1985 and began my radio career roaming around the country searching out alternative FM formats, but I always kept up with Norman. Be it a hiking trip with his family in central Idaho or finding him in the wilds of northern New Mexico. You saw the pictures at his record cave. A visit with Norman always turned into an adventure with Norman. I remember visiting his home in Lagunitas during the KTM days. I walked into his living room where on display what had to be 5,000 LPs. Norman, in his best radio voice, challenged his guests, name a record. He said, I've got it. Someone suggested Leonard Nimoy. Norman moved his ladder. You know, the kind they have in libraries. He took three steps up and pulled out the two sides of Leonard Nimoy. Enough said.
Hi, my name is Rusty Goldman. And I grew up in, thank you. I'm also known as Professor Poster. I do history of rock and roll posters every day on Facebook, as Terry knows. Thank you, Terry. I'm a native San Franciscan, grew up, born and raised here, and with a sister and brother, 6 and 8 years older than I. I grew up with their music. And early on, you know, as I, far back as I can remember, listening to KOBY and KWB and all the AM stations that were available. And then FM started coming in and KMPX happened and KSAN happened. And I used to run an antique limousine service at the time. And I was always out in my driveway working on my limousine and with the radio on, obviously. And one day I was out there and I heard a SOS from KSAN that they had someone up in Oregon, a new DJ, that they wanted to bring down to San Francisco, and they didn't know how to get him down here with all his menagerie and his family. And they needed someone to do it in a weekend. And it was on a Friday that they called, that they sent out this. Do you remember this? You don't remember this. Anyway, you were small. You were very young. I don't even remember what year it was. But I looked at my friend and I said, hey, road trip. And so we went downtown on Market Street to a truck rental and rented a great big step van. And our deal with KSAN was they were going to give us, I don't know how much money to do this, but I know it wasn't enough. And they gave us directions, and we made our way up to Oregon, and nonstop, with a little help. And finally, we found our way to the address that was given to us, and there was Norman saying, it's about time. We only have so much time to get down to San Francisco. So we loaded up this giant step van with God knows everything and followed Norman out the door and onto the highway and made it down to, I don't know if it, we were going to Petaluma or where it was, but it was Marin County for sure. And we finally got there and got the truck unloaded. And we didn't know how we were going to pay for this. So just to make sure that we weren't going to get in too deep, we disconnected the mileage gauge to the transmission. So we put like 30 miles on the truck on the odometer. But we had, you know, the trip going all the way up to Oregon and back was actually what the mileage was. Anyway, so we ended up getting back to San Francisco at like 6 a.m. in the morning after unloading. And we were going down California Street, and I was power shifting over the big hills in this giant truck. And in one shift, I pulled the whole stick shift came off the transmission inside the cab. So I'm sitting here with the shifter in my hand, and we're stuck in gear, and I don't know what the heck to do. So we finally pulled over and called a tow truck and got the truck towed back to the yard, and they were very apologetic to us and gave us our money back. And so we made it there, and we were able to pay for gas. And I established a rapport with what I ended up calling the man with the velvet voice, Norman Davis. And we became fast friends. And he said, you know, anytime you want, once I get established, come down to the station. You know, you're more than welcome. I could use you. And he had the midnight to 6 a.m. shift. And that was my time of night, because during those days, we had a lot of help. And so I went down, and I finally, you know, made my way into the station, and I said to Norman, well, you know, this is great. I loved watching him interact with the people on the radio and, you know, turning the discs. And I said, what do you want me to do, Norman? He says, well, you just sit at the desk here, and you just roll some joints, and here's a mirror. You just keep chopping what you can, which I supplied at the time, and answer the phones when people call, and answer the door and let people in, and you play concierge while I turn the discs. And I was in heaven. This was the most fun I had ever. You know, because all the people from all over the Bay Area, you know, KSN was the happening radio station. And everybody wanted to be a part of, you know, not just listening, they wanted to come visit too. And they'd bring us food, and they'd bring us candy, and they'd bring us bombers. And it was no end to the things that, and really pretty girls used to come by too. And which was always a treat. And over the years, we remained very close friends, and I made sure that every year on Norman's birthday, I would call him up, and he reciprocated, and every year on my birthday, he would call me back and wish me a happy birthday. And we had a truly a fine bromance, you know, it was wonderful. I loved having him as my friend, and whenever he'd come into the Bay Area on occasion, you know, I would go over to Marin County. I live in Pacifica, so it wasn't just around the corner, but I'd go over to Marin County and make sure that I got to have a visit with my dear friend. And I don't remember where I got it, but I have this picture of Norman on a button, and it's been on one of the columns in my house for as long as I can remember. And every day when I get up and I go downstairs to go to my kitchen, I pass this column and I see Norman. I say, Norm, how you doing? And so he's always with me every day. And I love him, and he was a blessing in my life, and someone that I'll never forget. And thank you, wherever you are.
Hi, everybody. I'm Nancy Walton. Norman and I worked together at my last San Francisco radio station, which was Coffee FM, very short-lived. Crazy ride, but we ended up.
So we can see you.
Maybe I can.
I'll get her here. Yeah, one lobster box.
There you go. Is that better?
Yeah, much.
I can talk better into it too. Yeah, so we were hired by Tom O'Hare, and Norman followed me on the air. I was on the air 6 to 10, and he was on 10 to 2 p.m., 10 p.m. to 2 a.m., and we became fast friends, shared lots of talk in between our shows, and we also shared some crosstalk on the air. I do have a tape, which I didn't get a chance to make another dub of it, but it is of us. He had me stay, and I don't remember what we were talking about, but it went on for about 45 minutes, which was long for crosstalk between shows. I found out that Norman had worked at a station that I had worked at, and actually it was Tom O'Hare who hired Norman at KZL in Eugene, and then 10 years after that, I got a job there too. And we ended up working together, and Tom O'Hare hired me for Coffee FM as well. Let's see. Oh, besides talking about music, he turned me on to a lot of great music, and I think I gave him some tips too, because he asked me about what I played the next day when he came into work, particular songs. But we shared an interest in UFOs, we discovered early on. And we just gabbed yak about UFO stories, because I'm from Montana and we have a lot of UFO stories there. Everybody I know has some encounter or knows of someone. So Norman and I talked a lot about that. But he invited me over because he had a pretty big library of books about UFOs. And also he wanted me to see a videotape about a Swiss farmer named Billy Meyer, the one-armed farmer, who apparently was contacted by the aliens, who said, "We want you to take pictures of us because no one will challenge you because you're one-armed, so you couldn't have held the camera up." He had to set it up and take the pictures. And yeah, so that was one of our interests. One of my favorite things that Norman did, though, one of my most indelibly etched memories, was when he asked me if I had ever seen Todd Rundgren in concert, and I had not, and he insisted that I go to the show, and finally he said, "I will take you to the show because I want to make sure that you see Todd Rundgren. You won't be disappointed." He wouldn't tell me anything more about it, though, but he insisted that I go. And so we went, and he stood on the sides, and he said, "Go right up to the front." And I had never seen Todd Rundgren. I liked his music, and I was blown away by the energy. And women were going crazy. One woman, while Todd was singing, threw her underwear, and it landed right on the microphone. And I glanced over at Norman, and he just had a big grin on his face. But I was really, seriously, I'm so grateful to him for having suggested and made me go to see Todd Rundgren in concert. When it was over and I walked back over to where he was standing, he had his arms crossed and just a smile on his face, and he said, "I told you so." The reason I wanted to talk today, I wasn't going to say anything, but I was on a road trip with my friends Kate Ingram and Buzzy Donahue down from Port Townsend to come to Norman's memorial today. And we came down I-5. I suggested that we do this because I wanted to see Mount Shasta again. I've had some pretty cosmic experiences there, and even just driving past there. As we got closer and we stopped to take some pictures of Mount Shasta at the rest stop, Norman's face came into my mind. He was clearly there, and I remembered that it was Norman who said to me, "Nancy, the reason there are so many UFO sightings at Mount Shasta is because it is a crystal mountain, and that's how they power up their spaceships to be able to travel to other planets without making any sound or causing any pollution." So thank you, Norman, for that, and for inspiring me to come down today, because I'm really happy to hear everybody's stories.
I'm Kate Ingram, and I worked at KSAN from 1978 to 79. One of the saddest things about my final arrival at KSAN was that the first day I worked there, which was the 15th of July, 79, was Norman's first day not to work there.
Wow.
He had been canned on Friday night, and that was a sad, sad thing for a lot of us. Anyway, I worked there for a year, and I left and went to BCN in Boston. It was a great time. I came back and worked at KSJO. I had worked there before. I worked at KUSF for 10 years, and we had a show that Ben, who's in the room, and I kind of conjured up that was called Jive Radio, and it was to rekindle the jive spirit in San Francisco. And many of the people who worked at KSAN came there to do shows on a rotating basis. And what I want to tell you about Norman is that even though he didn't live in San Francisco at that time, it was from about 1992 to about 1998 that this show went on, he would send in shows every month, and he would make them and he would record them on 10-inch reels and send them in so that we could play them. And KUSF was a college station, so in the spirit of just, you know, keeping that alive, I feel like Norman really carried that torch so much, and that it was really an important contribution, just like he made. So it was an unmentioned thing because he did so many great things, but I just have to acknowledge that it made a big difference to a lot of people, and the spirit is still alive.
Hi, my name is Jeff Heyman, and I was an intern at KSAN back in 1978, worked on Richard Gossett's show, but I was a KSAN groupie for a lot longer than that. I grew up in San Francisco, we used to come down, hang out in the booth, record plant. But what I'm really up here to say is there's this portion that no one's mentioned about Norman, and that was his Outcast show that introduced a lot of us, including me, to punk rock. And I'm forever great. I would stay up. I think it started at 2 a.m. And I was, I don't know, in high school. And, you know, you had to stay up and listen to this thing. And it was crazy. And if you have never heard Norman's interview with the Sex Pistols, it is a wonder KSAN was not thrown off the air. He did an amazing job. It was 3 hours of sheer anarchy. So thanks, Norman, wherever you are.
I wonder if I could churn some milk with this thing here. I like vintage stuff.
Union
page? Yes. I'll show you my neighbor card.
It's a union card there.
Is that comfortable?
Yeah, it reminds me of my dad when he used to play big bands. He had the big cardioid microphones, you know? He had this lead singer that was a complete jerk. So he went to the store and ring the ring with Limburger cheese, and then as the lights were hitting that, it was just like fomenting on his face. Anyway, so I'm John Schuster. I was a bass player and singer in the band the Imposters, and we were on the traveling rock and roll circus. Now, I knew Norman a little bit before then. I have to get Lobster up here because I have to apologize to him again. But anyway, so we would do the rock and roll circus, and Norman cooked up this thing. It was so much fun because he's on the side looking at the clock because we couldn't be there that long because we didn't want to gut the cops or somebody come in and say, where's your permit? I mean, we played in front of San Francisco, you know, City Hall. We played all over the place. But one of the funniest things I thought was we had this guy named Cosmo the Juggler, and Cosmo the Juggler always dropped something. And so we would play Wipeout. So when the drummer Johnny Campbell would play the solo on the Wipeout, he dropped something. And you could see Norman on the side kind of laughing a little bit. And you were there, right? Yeah. But anyway, where's Lobster? Did he just leave the room? I got to have Lobster. Did you run away? Lobster left the room. Okay. Anyway, Norman was a blessing. And okay, come on, get up here, man. Because this is funny stuff. So Norman would promote our band. You know, there's a lot of punk rock stuff going on. And Norman would promote the band, The Imposters and stuff, and we'd go down to KSAN, and then we ended up going to KSGO. Right. But then you were emceeing that one night at the Stone in San Francisco.
They were my client from my company, Flow Communications.
There we go.
Just like they were a client.
Yeah. That's right, I've got one of those voices that's not quiet.
I'm not quiet, don't worry.
Don't need the microphone.
Okay, there we go, there we go.
Really, I'm from the Bronx, I don't need a microphone.
So anyway, our band's playing a gig at the Stone, and Lobster, there's their emceeing. So anyway, bands are always playing practical jokes. So I get home, and I open up my travel bag, and here's these really enormously huge tennis shoes. I'm going, who do they belong to? I get a call the next day, and John, do you have some tennis shoes that don't belong to you in your bag, you know? I said, yeah, I don't know what they belong to. Well, they belong to Lobster. And poor Lobster, he had to get a taxi and go home in his lobster costume that night from San Francisco. Well, anyway, we went back to the radio.
They were spray painted red.
Yes, they were. But anyway, God bless Norman. We had a lot of fun with him, and the traveling rock and roll circus was great. He also helped produce our band at Tewksbury Sound in Richmond, which when I was a kid growing up, I used to go there to get Jawbreakers and rock candy, and they turned it into a studio. And there's Norman in the studio, and he's just sitting in the corner. He's just rolling doobies and having a good old time. And it was just a lot of fun to be around because he was such a joy to be with. So God bless him and wherever he is today.
One thing I left out was the Moonlight Groove Highway, which was Rachel Donahue putting it together from the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame in Cleveland. And it was one thing that Ben didn't mention because I produced for Ben at my studio in San Francisco. And it was me and Ben, well, first Ben, then Norman and me, and we had Commander Cody doing the show, and we had San Francisco Saturday night. So we had that on this Moonlight Groove Highway network that Rachel was trying to do out of the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame in Cleveland with this guy that I shall remain nameless because he burned me for the last check for everybody's show for over a month. But who's next?
I'm going to be next.
Steve.
I won't keep you long. I'm Steve Cushman, for those of you who don't know me. And I've been affiliated with C.H.R.S. since 1988. I was president from 1996 until earlier this year, and now I'm a director. I got three quick Norman stories. When I was at City College Radio in 1970, I was program director at the time of City College Radio, and for 4 hours a day, we were on KALW. So we were actually we're 20 hours a week on KALW. We needed guest speakers at the time. So at that time, I was tasked with getting a guest speaker for our broadcasting class, for our radio class. And I don't know who, if you would ever remember him, there was a guy on KSFO, this was 1971, there was a guy on KSFO named John Gilliland.
Oh yeah!
And he was a very straight-laced radio kind of guy. And at the last minute, he got sick or something, so they called over and says, we're gonna send this guy Norman Davis over to you guys. And it was the best thing that could have happened to a bunch of college broadcasters, because we left all relishing in Norman's organic mind garden, etc. One Norman story. Second Norman story, I was honored and pleased to be invited to, thank you, Susie, Norman's 80th birthday party. And that was really special. And the third thing, right after I heard Norman had passed, And, you know, feeling kind of lousy, but he had a good run, as I tell everybody. I'm going through this building, and you may not understand. We've been here 10 years, and there are still boxes we haven't opened since we moved in. Things come, things go here. There's so many people. There's so much going on. So I was looking for brackets, or I was looking for something, and I go way back in the corner there, and I see a box, and it's addressed to me. But it's been open, and the date was like a long time before. And and this is a couple of days after Norman passed. And I opened the box, and this was in it. This is Norman's KCIN. Susie has been really good about, you know, kind of funneling historical stuff our way. So she had sent it to me months and months before. Somebody opened it and didn't tell me about it and stashed it away. But Norman was reaching out, and we remember him and we love him. He was the best. That's all I can say.
So Steve, I think we're going to play that little
video.
I think we're just going to have to wrap it up, just because I think people are getting a little bit restless. But I thank you so much for all coming. And, you know, while going through Dad's archives, which me and my brothers are doing, we discovered some things about Dad we didn't know. Like, one of the things we didn't know was that he actually could sing really well, because he never sang in public. I never heard my dad sing. But back when he was in his early 20s, he had two reel-to-reel tape recorders, and he did some overdubbing of some vocal work, and I wanted to play that for you right now.
This is Norman.
I never saw my dad do was dance. He just would never dance in public. And so just for this event, I decided to make him dance for us. We stumbled across all the negatives for this record shoot. And so here's Norman dancing.
Come on, baby, let's do that twist.
Yeah, I threw in a little Tom Donahue at the end, because we had some negatives of him in there, too. So we're going to bring this gathering to a close. And once again, thank you so much. It's been such a great celebration of my dad. I want to say thank you to Steve and the incredible California Historical Radio Association. And I also just want to give a shout out to so many of Norman's radio friends who've already left us. A lot of you know these guys. A lot of you love them. Wild Bill Scott, Bobby Dale, Tom O'Hare, Bob McClay, Tom Donahue, Scoop Nisker, Dave McQueen, the amazing Dusty Street. Yeah. Is there anybody else I left out? Stephen Ponick.
David T.
Thank you. Let's just give these guys a... We love you guys. Radio legends. Thank you. So on the day that my dad was cremated, I went down to the funeral home and
just to be with his physical form for the last time, and kind of sang some songs, told some stories, and then I just was like, okay, I just got to sit here with this. I'm not really sure how it ends. And I just sat there, and then all of a sudden these words just popped into my head, and they were, go forth and be weird. And I'm like, okay, I'm good with that, you know, it's time to move on. And so I'm gonna bring up Keita Bill to sing a song to close this thing. And for weeks I was like, what song are we gonna do? What is the best song? And then, boom, it popped into my head, and it's an obscure song that Dad used to play all the time on KSAN. It's called Celebrate Life. And so I think this is also a message from Norman for all of you. And this is Keita Bill. Oh, those are great pants, girl.
You know, I was hoping you would notice these pants, because they're the most rowdy pair of pants I have in my collection. And I think Norman would kind of like them, so. All right, so Susie said, you got to sing this thing, so I'm going to need a little assist, but that's okay. That's all right. Woo! He would say this, right? She's ready for radio.
Thursday edition. Norman Davis back in pretty good shape after last night's Christmas party at Radio KY, and we'll swing till midnight with our requests and dedications as usual.